Welcome to Business on the Wire. In the previous episode, we heard what mental health challenges for entrepreneurs look like and what the unique pressure points are for those who run businesses of their own. While the post-lockdown period has seen economic activity resume and unemployment figures actually improve, the situation remains extremely grim for the economy and for jobs. Smaller businesses have been forced overnight to completely rest their operations, change direction, and often let go of ideas they were deeply invested in. It isn't a one-size-fits-all situation, though. For industries like travel, tourism, and hospitality, the past few months have been hell, and at this point, there's no clarity on how long it will remain that way. I spoke with Harshvardhan Tanwar, who's co-founder of No Footprints, an organization that curates niche travel experiences across Indian cities.
Oh, definitely. I can't stress on the fact that, you know, as travel entrepreneurs or travel as an industry, we were the first to hit and we'll be the last to recover. And that's the global scenario. And the job fatalities that have happened, I think travel has faced the most number of job fatalities so far. You know, we work in the inbound space, which we 95% of our clientele comes from overseas, 5% we do for locals as pop-ups. And you don't know what the future is because it depends on when the source destinations open their borders, how comfortable are people traveling to densely populated countries such as ours, what are going to be the new normals, what are the kind of social distancing norms that are going to be in place. So all of that is in a cloud of uncertainty right now. And the hospitality space is bleeding, be it hotels, you know, be it of course restaurants right now, be it airlines, and of course experience providers such as ourselves. It's important, and it doesn't help that there's a certain lack of empathy from the government. You're looking at nearly about a little over 12% of the country's population being employed directly or indirectly by tourism. You're also looking at tourism being a contributor of a little over 8% when it comes to the GDP of the country. So it's disheartening to see that there is little or no respite given to this industry. However, for us, we've always believed that tourism will survive. It has survived the 2001 when the attacks happened on the Twin Tower. It survived post the 2008 depression, and when it was viable for people to travel, they did. We're true nomads at heart, and I believe that the industry will survive. Whether it's going to go back to its original space, I believe that it's going to come back and come back with a bang, but that's my personal opinion. Of course, there will be a lot of factors that are taken into consideration. How the economy is going to go, how many times the people are going to travel, you know, what are the kind of restrictions on travel that are going to be in place. There are a lot of factors that are going to be affected. But yeah, you know, travel at this point of time is the most hit. I mean, we are sitting on next to no income, actually no income right now. But we are hopeful. We are looking at newer avenues, looking at newer pastures, looking at newer TG. Till our core target audience starts traveling, I think travel entrepreneurs need to keep reinventing themselves. And, you know, we are looking at product because that's where our space is. And the beauty of product is that it always evolves. And that's what we're doing. We are evolving our content. We are evolving our products. And we are suiting it to the new TG. It's tough times for all of us. But, you know, we know for a fact that tourism will bounce back. And when it does, we'll be ready to face any new challenges that are there.
Is the experience different for female entrepreneurs? Is it tougher because of societal expectations that are often placed squarely on the shoulders of the woman of the household? Here's what Priya Krishnan, founder and CEO of Clay Schools, told me.
I think, you know, women entrepreneurs have one, then most women entrepreneurs are self-funded. There is a lot of micro enterprises in the space, and hence, you know, that semblance of funding that you would see, which is your revenue streams largely from customers, is impacted. And to that extent, those businesses feel a much higher pressure than businesses that are funded by private equity or VC. So just given a lot more women are in the micro-enterprise space, I think the impact would be significantly higher. The social narrative in terms of, you know, support at home, children at home, you know, catering, caring for elders at home, etc. That also adds, you know, you have, in a sense, your household, your day job, and your children's education, which sort of lands. And it is true that, you know, women in general take that on, that household load on a lot more significantly than men in the household. And to that extent, it is difficult. But having said which, you know, one feels blessed that I have an incredibly supportive husband and children and in-laws. And that isn't necessarily true for our staff. When you think about what they're going through at home, a lot of them going through their own set of issues. There is domestic violence that is involved. Their salaries are not coming in time. A lot of these women look for respite outside of the household, and that is their semblance of stability when they step out of the household into the schools. That respite's disappeared. So, you know, as a woman entrepreneur, I think, you know, the challenges would be very similar to what my male counterparts face, just because I'm blessed with the support at home.
While the struggles are real and often mentally exhausting, it's important to find a safe space to let the load off your shoulders. Investors have the opportunity to play an enormous role in supporting entrepreneurs through this Black Swan event. Here's Akash Bhatia, co-founder and CEO at Infinite Analytics, and what he found when he turned to his investors in this crisis.
Absolutely. I think investors play a huge role in sort of supporting the entrepreneur through such crisis. When COVID hit, most of the investors that we have in the company didn't even know that we were repurposing the platform until you know, a lot of people, you know, as lockdown hit, investors started to call and see how we were doing, what was happening, and so on and so forth. And once they realized that this is what we were working towards, I think they were both happy and relieved. First thing that, you know, we'd found something that we were able to work on, and something that would give us a purpose, something that would give us some revenues as well, and good words of advice on how to navigate a different field, how to navigate a pandemic, what to look for, how to approach the commercials, how to while keeping in mind that this is a pandemic and it's not a revenue making opportunity. Multiple conversations over you know, how to sort of align the team, multiple conversations over you know, what happens next if this, you know, if this pandemic doesn't get over, or the economy doesn't open up in the next 3 months, what should be the next steps? Should we fundraise? Should we not fundraise? How do we fundraise? What do we do? A lot of those questions that dog entrepreneurs were sort of brainstormed with the investors. In fact, some of the investors even spoke with us regarding, hey, how do we take what we have built in the platform for contact tracing and mobility analysis into our regular business as well? So there was a constant flow of interaction. Plus, they did not pressurize us into giving monthly updates that we need to give or that we provide to them, because everybody knew that there was so much turbulence, there was so much in uncertainty, that to expect entrepreneurs to do everything that they were doing pre-COVID was not really the right thing. And so absolutely supportive, and I think that also helped us keep our sanity. And as a result of which, I think my answer to your question is yes, investors play a huge role in supporting entrepreneurs and through not only a pandemic, but through other crises as well.
So is there a safety net you can build for yourself? The answer is an emphatic yes. Back to my conversation with Dr. Amit Malik, who's co-founder and CEO at InnerR. you know, you straddle both worlds, so you know, you really have a unique sort of insight into this. I mean, do you think as a construct and a society, we don't talk about the failure of entrepreneurs enough? You know, we're always talking about the unicorns and the successes, which is such a minuscule percentage of people who go down the entrepreneurial journey. Do you think we need to be more vocal, and especially post this pandemic, about things that failed? Because guess what? It's okay to fail.
I can't remember the stat now. I think it's 3,000 startups, or 300 startups, 300 of the 3,000 startups that started in the last 5 years have shut down the last 3 months. Some it's a broad number. I think 10% of whatever was started, some 14 to 20 have shut down really in the last, and this is about $760 million of venture capital funding that's gone down the drain with companies shutting down, right? I agree completely, right? So if you think about, and that tells you that it's not unusual, right? It's actually unusual if you succeed rather than if you fail, and doesn't get talked about enough. Absolutely, compared to a couple of colleagues in the Valley who start and shut down companies as if it's taking a holiday, and they just say, okay, we started, we'll give it 6 months, we'll see where we get to, we'll give it a year, and if it doesn't come down, we'll shut it down, then we'll decide what to do next, right? So there's very little stigma attached to failure there. Whereas here, I think a combination of the lack of open conversation, how society in this country more generally attaches so much of your identity to what your career and profession and job and salary is, right? Yeah. So that level that your job has on your identity is plays out in a big way. And thirdly, a lack of trust that exists in the startup ecosystem as well, right? So people don't often talk openly to each other, right? Because they're scared of sharing information. So I think all those three things play out. And I think entrepreneurs have to share some of the responsibility of that as an ecosystem, as an individuals, because it has to start somewhere, right? There have been two or three fascinating pieces in popular media in the last 2 years of founders shutting down businesses and openly talking about their experience of how they started and how they shut down, right? And some of the failures they talked about. I think we need a lot more of that, a lot more of that openness to talk about businesses failing, because they are very likely to. That's simple as that.
You mentioned the need for a community, Amit. Do you think there's also a big role here to play, especially for entrepreneurs, for investors? Because, you know, there is pressure, and there is often a lot of pressure coming in from your investors. A large part of India's entrepreneurs may be business families, but they're also people running a solo ship who are answering to someone. Do you think it's time for investors to do a bit of soul searching in terms of their relationship with the entrepreneur?
My perspective is very skewed, so I might not be the best person to ask this question, because I've had very supportive investors. Very, very supportive investors through good times and bad times, especially through bad times in the journey. And frankly, even the investors we've spoken to in the last few months have been very cognizant of the space we're in, the environment we're in, and have had very supportive conversations around that. So I think by and large, the investor community now is reasonably evolved, at least at the sort of the tech ecosystem, but entrepreneurship stage. I don't know much about the public investing space at all, and then the larger sort of traditional businesses, so I wouldn't be able to speak to that. But on the sort of tech investor ecosystem, I think a lot of them are people who've been investors for a long time, have a fair cosmopolitan bent of mind, whether it's Indian or global, and so they really understand the challenges and are quite supportive broadly. And this is my experience of talking to other founders who are venture funded or Series B, Series C funded, where they've actually found the last few months and the investor relations becoming stronger rather than strained in most scenarios. So I think there is definitely a degree of evolution there. I've only heard positive stories around that, and might be skewed there.
I know there's no one-stop solution over here, because everyone's story is their own. But you know, what would you lay out as a couple of things to keep in mind in order to ring fence yourself mentally in a situation like this?
And this is generic advice, right? It applies to everybody, right? But more so to founders, because they have the biggest challenges in maintaining boundaries of all employees in a company. I think there is starting with hygiene, right? And what do I mean by that, right? So actually, it's very, very important, and I couldn't stress this enough. People say things very generic advice, but then I often question as to how many people actually follow it, is to actually have a routine, right? Actually have a schedule in this current context, right? It is super important. And that schedule should really consist of a whole bunch of things, right? It should consist of, if you're working from home or going to office, whatever the new normal for you is, it should really consist of some amount of time, 10 to 15 minutes for meditation or reflective time. It should really consist of some degree of physical exercise. It should consist of meal time that's regular. It should consist of 7 to 8 hours of sleep. So those are the non-negotiables that your schedule has to have, right? The idea that you can bank sleep, the idea can you can bank meals and food, the idea that you can bank rest, the idea that you can do exercise next month are all fallacies. It doesn't get banked 1:1, it gets banked 1:5. So you end up paying 5 times more the price for it later on when you haven't done it on a daily basis. So that's one big sort of suggestion is to have that schedule, mirror it to as if you were going to work in the normal times in terms of, you know, I'm sitting here, I've gotten up in the morning, I've exercised, I've showered, I've had my breakfast, and then I got on my first call, right? And 4 days in a week, I've also exercised by now, right? So have that schedule and rituals around it and stick to them, right? Where it's possible, define your workspace. It's hard for everybody to do that. So I always say where it's possible because, you know, a lot of us live in very cramped accommodation. But even in that, define the workspace, right? So that you know that you're not confusing your bed with your office, essentially. And it's really important. That helps with sleep hygiene. It helps with managing your stress levels and keeping them contained to a certain context. So now I know when I'm in my room, that's not my workspace. Now I can relax there. Talk to people on a regular basis. Use technology to connect. I always recommend having at least one meaningful conversation every day that's not work-related. So connect with people, whether it's family members, close friends, friends you haven't spoken to for a long time. So connect every day and have one conversation on a daily basis at least, right? And 7 days a week. Practice self-compassion. It's hard.
Yeah.
It's okay to accept that it's hard. It's not failure to accept it's hard. It's really hard. Right now, for people running businesses, people running small businesses, people who are entrepreneurs, it's really, really hard. You're not alone. Everybody's in the same boat. Might be somebody's boat is slightly bigger than yours and somebody's boat is sinking a bit more than yours, but everybody's in the same boat. And recognize that things will get better. Right? What history of pandemics has told us throughout is that they evolved, right? So they all, and so whether it gets better in a month or 3 months or 6 months, I couldn't tell you, but things will get better, right? And finally, recognize that you are a person. Your company is not you. Drawing some distinction between you as the person and you as the founder is very, very important. That will allow you to treat yourself well, right? If how you treat yourself becomes very linked to how your company is performing right now, then you'll just end up treating yourself badly. So recognize that you are a person is very, very important. The last couple of things is be informed but not over-informed, right? Constantly tracking the news is, with all respect to all the journalists out there,
is not spikes.
The numbers are totally meaningless for an individual, right? They're very, very important for defining public policy and healthcare actions. But for an individual, what's important is what's in your control, right? What are the actions you need to take to protect yourself? What are the precautions you need to take for yourself and your business? Those are more important than how many deaths happened last night in Delhi and how many new cases were diagnosed in Chennai. They're not important. So inform but not over-inform, because being on the news all the time can trigger anxiety and distress itself. And then that gets reflected into other things. So that's the other thing I was going to say. And then finally, manage anxiety, right? So and how do you do that? So one is a relaxation activity, whether it's deep breathing or mindfulness or music, whatever relaxes you. And doing some degree of physical exercise, which is yoga or other physical exercises, is also very, very important. So those are some of the tips. Having a routine, practicing self-compassion, being informed but not over-informed, keep connecting to other people on a daily basis, and managing sort of anxiety by doing physical and psychological things every day, basically.
Yeah. No, that's fascinating and great advice. It's funny, I was reading a Mandarin term today that's been coined, Amit, for people who now stay up longer at night in order to exercise the feeling that they have freedom over their lives, because they're not getting that in the waking hours. So I think, you know, this is doing all kinds of things to us. But my final question to you, when you started our chat, you pointed out how the lives of entrepreneurs are filled with uncertainty. And when I've spoken to entrepreneurs, they've said that that's the biggest life lesson they're getting out of this. You know, how do you marry the two? You deal with a profession that has uncertainty, but here you are. This is as uncertain as it probably will get. Where's the reconciliation?
I think it's about control, right? It's about focusing on the controllables.
Yeah.
So I was speaking to an entrepreneur a few weeks ago, and they reached out and really was seeking advice on, they just can't get going. There's just so much going wrong right now with their business. They just don't know where to start. then and they, if they do this, they don't know if that will happen and whether that will work out. And so what we always spend time on, and this is somebody, a friend. I haven't seen him in a professional capacity. I was just helping him out as a friend. We just sat down and said, okay, why don't we just make a list of not of things that can go wrong, not of things that are your worries, but things that you can actually do. Right? What can you actually, let's just make a list of things that you can actually do. Like, you can pick each worry, and that's fine. We'll go through each of them one at a time. And for each worry, what can you actually do? Like, what are the controllables in your hand? And making a list of controllables, and then prioritizing them, and judging yourself just on that, right? Not judging on yourself on the business performance, because that's the only way you can manage uncertainty, right? If you look at some of the economies around the world, which are very volatile in the best of times, you look at South America, for example, and Argentina, I spent some time there a few years ago. You talk to a bunch of entrepreneurs there, and they are really focused on the process. And their controllables and the outcome, because there are so many external variables. The economy goes through an inflationary cycle every 10 years, right? So there's so many uncontrollables in their life that your business can totally go out of kilter. So they just focus really on the controllables. They understand the reality and then say, okay, then what are the controllables and I'm talking the successful ones there, what are the controllables that they can work on, prioritize them, and just judging themselves from being able to do the controllables, not on the outcome themselves. And that's all you can do as a founder. There's so many uncertainties right now in terms of the external environment that with your best of effort, you could fail. Right? But if you start judging yourself on the outcome of the business right now or the outcome of an effort, you will be setting yourself up to a very miserable existence. And so my recommendation is get down a piece of paper, put down all the things you can do on a piece of paper, or actually in this case with a notebook because there were too many of them, and then prioritize them, literally put numbers next to them, and then focus and judge yourself only on your ability to do that work rather than what the outcomes are essentially.
I think this is solid advice for journalists as well, Amit. Thank you so much for joining in today. I appreciate your time and thought. Thank you.
My pleasure, Zari. Thanks a lot.
Talking about your emotional or mental state is often a conversation that's brushed under the carpet. The focus is on normalizing the strain, playing the fake it till you make it game, and never stepping away. But entrepreneurship is tough, tougher still when you're up against an unknown like a pandemic. The important takeaway is it's okay to ask for help, it's okay to seek a community that supports your struggles, and the onus is on investors, clients, governments, and everyone in between to recognize and support a business owner. Thanks for watching.